stand up. Let us recognize you. Welcome. Probably the only guest I should introduce is my wife, Janine, who's going to be mad at me for doing this. So, hello there, my dear. How are you? So, we're really lucky today. We have a meeting with a great sponsor. It's an incredible law firm that I've had a chance to work with for many years. There's these two guys over there that I'm kind of a little fond of. And Ali, as everybody knows, is the chairman for the Arizona Bowl and was the guy that created it and talked the rest of us into saying yes. Ali, as a sponsor, please come up and say some words to us. To embarrass Ali, did anybody see the news conference yesterday where they made a big announcement with the AZ Bowl? I will tell you that's a game changer, and I hope my pal Ali says something about it. It's not a secret anymore, is it, Ali?
What an ass. Man, I didn't ask Ali I was talking today, so I definitely feel like that was appropriate. Glad everybody can be here today. We, from the Arizona Bowl hat perspective, we're very excited about our new partnership with Barstool Sports. Their digital platform, their media power, is going to shine a spotlight on our community like never before. And for all of you that like a good party, you know, with the Arizona Bowl and the University of Arizona Downtown Bowl Bash, we created a really good party that ended with a taco drop at midnight. But you really need to hydrate and maybe get a hotel room, because it's going to be a week. This is going to be Tucson's Mardi Gras, and the entire nation will be watching, and good for us. The three pillars of what we're about is to shine, to bring out the best of our community and tell the entire world, because I think sometimes we don't do that enough, and sometimes we have a self-defeatist narrative, and it's time to change that narrative. So this will give us a platform to tell the Tucson story to the rest of the world. Number two, all that proceeds go to local nonprofits. We want to give as much money to local charities as possible. And number three, create significant economic impact that all of our community, all of our residents benefit from. You know, thanks to our executive director, Kim Adair, our staff, our volunteers, our board of directors. We've done a fairly good job of that. All those three pillars are on hyperdrive now. So we're really excited about it. Hope to see you all on New Year's Eve at the Arizona Bowl, at the Barstool Sports Arizona Bowl, who's also our executive broadcast partner. Farhang and Metcalf, we've got a bunch of our team here, and any good coach will tell you that a great coach, people say you're a great coach, that means you have a lot of great players. We have a great team. It's a multi-dimensional, multi-practice law firm. We do just about everything. We really believe the ethos of our firm is giving back to the community as well. And in line with the Arizona Bowl, the ethos of our firm, we couldn't be more proud to sponsor someone like Adia Barnes, the women's basketball coach, being here today, because Adia Barnes kind of represents everything we've been talking about. Think about where we were coming out of the pandemic on personal levels, from the university level. Think about all the things that were going on at the university. Adia Barnes brought an energy and a passion to women's basketball and the University of Arizona that I think you all felt and made our community a better place, and those things matter. So we're really proud to be sponsoring the event. Hope everybody has a good lunch. I can't wait to get Mark back. It was gonna be three times as bad. And we're gonna embarrass the crap out of him. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Ali. In case you don't misunderstanding, if Adia doesn't show up, you do not get your money back. So kind of interesting, you know, we, under Bob Logan's administration, we moved the speakers up to before all of club business. to ensure that we had plenty of time to let them speak. Since she's not here, we're going to jump into a little bit of club business, and we'll start off with happy birthdays. First up is Robin Stoddard, somebody we all know quite well. He was born on July 7th. He joined in December of 97. His classification is education, aviation education. He is with Wright Flight. He's a graduate of Colorado State, and he's a pal. He does a heck of a great thing with kids. He was asked, like everybody, to tell us a couple things about him. There are a few things you don't know about him. He was born in Japan. He won a national championship in the Arizona Guard pistol team. He was not successful on Who Wants to Be a Millionaire. He joined Rotary, actually, after he made a presentation about his charity, Right Flight. He stays because he loves the camaraderie, the folks, and the good causes. And he plans to stay and support the car show even more. Robin?
Thank you, President. President Dick Gallagher gave me a Paul Harris Award right before I left for Afghanistan last time. And when I was there in 05, my last combat mission, 50 years old, we had secured the country. Young ladies were going to school for the first time. Sadly, a lot of those successes may be going away soon. But I do appreciate being a member of Rotary. For those of you that may not know about Wright Flight, or named after the Wright brothers, we have kids sign a contract. If they raise their grades in school, they get to fly an airplane, actually take over and fly an airplane. So during COVID, we didn't fly that much, but we typically fly 600 to 700 kids a year. Operations in several states, thanks to volunteers like Tom Willis, Mike Anderson, Larry Adamson, Faye Morse, and others, Doc. We need volunteers, we need supporters. I just want to share a letter from a teacher and from a kid, and I'll wrap things up. This is a teacher in the Vail School District. She's thanking Right Flight because she did Right Flight in fifth grade 25 years ago. Now she's doing the program in her school. She just handed off the program, the Right Flight program, to another student, another teacher. Then last Saturday, April 17th, this was during COVID, we're coming out of COVID, I got to watch my own son participate in this flight day. His father went to jail in November. And on top of everything else this last year brought, losing his dad for an uncertain amount of time just crushed him. Right Flight was a saving grace for both of us. It was a motivator for him to work hard and something positive for him to look forward to. It's also amazing for me because it gave us something to bond over and forced me to make time each week to spend on him studying and talking about what he learned. The kids have to earn the right to fly, and they have to take over control of the plane. One young girl from the Indian Reservation wrote us, "Thanks for going flying with me, for our pilot, Mr. John Foster. I know we really didn't talk much, but I really had a great time. I'm looking forward to an aviation career someday. America needs aviators, and America needs mechanics." So, the girl in the middle of the Indian Reservation is looking forward to an aviation career. P.S. Please excuse me for throwing up.
Do you know why you are sticking a banana before you go on some kind of wacky airplane ride? Tastes the same coming up as it does going down.
Oh.
Sorry, I'm going to get to that here a little bit. Secret Service has just been reported that Adia is in the house. So we're going to jump into one more quick birthday. We're waiting for her. We've got Tom Willis up next. He was born July 15th. He joined in September of 2015. His classification is accounting and financial services. He's a CPA in private practice. He's with Gold, Black & Decker, and Lawson. And he is a University of Nevada graduate. Tom.
Thank you, President Mark. Before I forget, I pass on some donations for the scholarship and for the Polio Plus program. Before I forget, you know, age and all, sometimes you forget. But, you know, age is a funny thing. I remind you what Satchel Paige said once. Age doesn't mind if you don't, it doesn't matter. And so I thought that as long as you think young, you should be okay. Don't ever give up. And another quote, I think, comes recently, I heard Joe Namath say, he's in the fourth quarter playing for overtime. So that's where I'll be positive. I want to thank everybody for letting me in this club. I came from Pasadena, moved over here in June of 15, and I came into this club just to see what it was like, and it's the highest energy club I've ever been at. And I just enjoy being part of it. Thanks so much. The balance of my time, I yield to Scott Braun's next public address.
Scott has been restricted, no more mic time for Scott. By the way, I forgot to mention this. So Tom has 155 hours as a pilot. He joined Rotary to learn more about our Tucson community. He stays because of the interesting speakers and the opportunity to collect with other members. And he plans to continue volunteering for the car show to make it even better. We've got one more birthday person. Andy, we're going to push you off for just a little bit. We're going to ask Adia to come up. Coach? To coach over the weekend about the photo, and she thought I was telling her photo was antiquated. Pretty funny exchange, to be quite honest. Pretty funny. So we're lucky today to have our pal Adia, who's also an honorary member of our club, with us. We do have a short video introduction that we're going to do. I want to thank Matt Russell as our talking head and the famous Rick Rose, who doesn't know how to say no, for not only putting together the video, but just you guys know, Rick scripts all this stuff, and he records all this. So anyway, here's Adia.
The leading scorer in Arizona women's basketball history and a WNBA champion, Barnes came to Tucson after serving as an assistant coach at the University of Washington for 5 seasons. Coach Barnes proved to be a very successful recruiter, and as part of her coaching responsibilities, she made it a point for her players to get better in the classroom and get out into the community. As a result, the team had its best academic semester in a decade and led the entire athletic department in community service hours. In addition to her playing and coaching career, Barnes has been extremely active in the community through the Adia Barnes Foundation, which mentors underserved youth, conducts charitable events, and holds community service projects. In 2019, Coach Barnes led the Wildcats to victory over Northwestern, becoming the WNIT champions. And in 2021, the Wildcats beat the University of Connecticut Huskies to reach the Final Four for the first time ever. In the 2020-2021 season, Arizona still managed to win 20 games for the third year in a row, a feat that hasn't been accomplished since 2005. A native of San Diego, California, Barnes is married to Salvo Cova, who is also a basketball coach, and she's also the mother of one son, Mateo, and a daughter, Capri, who was featured with Adia during the nationally televised tournament. Let's have a warm championship welcome for U of A women's basketball coach, Adia Barnes.
I'm just going to do a formally kind of talk about how the year was and let you guys ask questions, because I figured you guys might accomplish it a little bit. But you said it all pretty much there. It was an amazing run last year. I think that there is a couple moments in that run where they're not my bright spots. Everybody saw I'm famous for this. And that was a moment, as a mom, I was like mortified that was showing. But then as a coach, I was like, I'm loving all my players. Like, I didn't really care. So they asked me, they were like, do you want to apologize? I was like, absolutely not. I was like, the camera shouldn't have been in the huddle. But definitely didn't want to be known for that. Because now every coach on the road, they're like, we give the birds, we say this is what it was an amazing year. No one, including myself, thought that we'd be in the championship game. We knew we were good. We knew we had talent. You know, Erin McDonald was just phenomenal. I mean, one of the best players in the country. You guys saw her. She just fast. She's all over. Just really came out of her shell towards the tournament. But what I can tell you is it all started, remember when I first came here? Culture, everything was kind of off, and that's why the job was open. So you know, thankfully the job was over, but building the culture was the essential thing. It was the thing that we had to do right, getting the right kids. You guys saw kids like Sam Thomas, Kate Reese, academics, like everything just kind of changed. And once you get good kids, you attract other good kids. But what made it so special about this year was that I was able to win, and we were able to go far with the players that came to Arizona when everybody said he shouldn't come. So we won 6 games Sam's first year. So that's why I think it was more meaningful for me. It was like, we went through the worst times. You know, it was hard. Like, losing Sam, had never lost that much. Everybody said, don't go to Arizona. Remember, Sam chose between us and Michigan. She didn't have any other Pac-12 offers. So to win with her and go to the championship game meant a lot. So couldn't have done it with a better group. And the group, we were perfect this year. We had parts of the year that, you know, we had some ups and downs. I can tell you, I don't know if a lot of you guys follow, but in the Pac-12 tournament, we played UCLA, we lost. Had a tough moment after the game. After the game, I was really frustrated, and I told the players, you guys tell your parents to shut the hell up. You know, that was, I wasn't proud of that, because during COVID, there was no fans. So I can hear all the parents, and I'm like, why are the parents yelling at me? You know, so I was like, are the parents yelling at me? They were like, yeah, so it was a moment. So we had a really rough patch. And then we had a meeting, it was a heart-to-heart, and they were like, we're mad that you said that about your parents. I was like, I'm sorry, I really shouldn't have said that. It was either one, I shouldn't have. But honestly, without that meeting, and without us kind of having heart-to-heart, and me kind of calling some people out, some people calling me out, we wouldn't have came together. But after that, it was like glue. So we had that adversity, we worked through it, we had some honest, tough talks, and then we just gelled. And after that, we really got momentum, and we got hot in the tournament. There wasn't one team that we really should have beat except for our first round. First round, Stony Brook, we should have beat them. After that, I mean, Boise won by 4 points. Could have lost against Boise State. And then if you go further, Texas A&M, all those teams were a lot better. But we had that it factor. We had that heart, the passion, and we just believed we can beat anybody. So I remember we were going into the UConn game. I mean, mind you, during COVID, it was really hard. We were on lockdown for 3 weeks. Couldn't leave the hotel, could not walk outside to do anything. Our only walk outside was like a controlled group and walking to go get testing. So our girl didn't have like any outdoor time, nothing. So it was a very hard 3 weeks. I mean, it was hard for me because I had 2 kids going crazy in the hotel room for 3 weeks. I was like, gonna die. I was like, 2 more days, I'm out of here. But that was like 3 weeks. But then we just kept winning. We kept on just making history. And I think that moment when we beat UConn, I pulled the team together and I said, after everybody didn't believe in us. And because I'm like, if you watch me coaching, I don't cuss at my team. I don't degrade them. That's just not how I coach. But I kind of felt like, forget everybody didn't believe in us. We believed in ourselves. We fought. I said, look around here. We believed in each other. No one in a million years thought we'd be here. And I was like, we're going to the championship game and everybody's kind of going crazy. But you know, then we had a tall task. Stanford, they're a better team than us. But we came within one basket of winning. I wasn't that happy as a coach at that last basket. I was devastated for months about it. I was like, we didn't get the shot we needed. But it was still, we accomplished so much. And I think that what's so special about Tucson is that I was down. I mean, to get the championship game, it's very hard to get there. And then losing, I felt like, oh, I failed. So I felt all the moms, I felt all the WNBA players. I felt, because there was a lot of weight, a lot of different hats I was wearing. I felt down, but then the moment that picked me up is we landed in Tucson. The fire department, like all kinds of marshals, police, they were all there. They had the water thing, even though we lost. And then on the way to McHale, there was thousands of people all the whole way from the airport. And I was like, we didn't win though. But everybody celebrated us and loved us and really just showed like how proud they were. And that really lifted me up in a really tough moment. So not only the whole camp, all the way down Campbell, I mean cars, signs, everything. We go into the football stadium and there's thousands of people. And so that was a moment where it's like, I could be a little bit proud. You know, finishing second, you're never proud of. But it was a moment when you guys really came out and showed us a lot of love in a difficult time. So thank you so much for that. And I'm excited. The future is bright. I think we have a different team this year, but we have a very talented team. As a coach, I don't want to coach a team that usually has one star player scoring 30 points a game. That's not the way I want to coach. Because if we already had a bad night, a lot of times we're going to lose. that's not how I want to coach. That's not my philosophy. So you'll see a good team this year with more balance. You'll see a lot more, we have a lot more girth inside. We have some big girls from the SEC. We're taller. We're better shooters on the perimeter. So maybe our defense will look a little bit different without Larry. But we're going to be a more complete team. And so I'm excited to see how we respond now that the target's on our back. But it's been fun. I mean, it's harder. When you're on top, it's hard to stay on top. So, you know, me as a coach, I feel some pressure. I feel some pressure in the sense, like, you don't want to be a one and done. You don't want to be like, oh, you were there because of Eric. No, you want to sustain. So we're recruiting. We've signed some of the best players in the country. Amaya Naji, Zeke Naji's sister. Remember, Zeke was our one and done. So his sister, who's a very talented player, we got her for Stanford, some other good schools. And she's also a 4.0 kid. And she's coming into Arizona on a 7-year medical school plan. So that President Robbins really helped me get her. It was great. He sold out. He's a person. You can help me. But I didn't even know there was a 7-year plan for medical school until she came. And then we have this girl, Kaylin Gilbert, from Florida, who's a really good driver down over in Louisville. So those are two players. We're looking to sign 3 more. So it's a really big class for us. But we're now we're able to get some of the best players that we couldn't get a couple years ago. So everything's different. Academically, we're one of the best. Community service, we continue to serve. And our players, it's not something I force. It's something they love to do. So as a coach, you love seeing that. They like going out and giving back, and I think that's what it's all about. And I know that this community wouldn't have rallied behind us if we didn't do those things. And so I really love the fact that our players do that. And then Sam Thomas won the highest, most prestigious award for academic and athletics. That was the Elite 90 Award, which was given away at the Final Four, so that's a huge accomplishment. And she's going to be up for Woman of the Year. So we've had 4 Women of the Year at NCAA. We've had multiple, she's academic All-American. We've had 3 other All-Pac-12 kids, and this is not, that shows the culture shift. It's going to happen a few years ago. So I'm excited, the future is bright, and I hope to see you guys out of games. And I'm just excited to go to a game where there's actually going to be fans. Because at the Final Four, there was a limited amount of fans. It doesn't even feel like there's fans. So I really feel like we're going to get 10,000 fans a game. And that's what I'm pushing for. And we're a good team. We'll be ranked top 10. And hopefully, knock on wood, we'll stay healthy and be better. So does anybody have questions for me?
I'm sure we have lots of questions.
Coming today. 2 years ago, my wife and I went to our first women's basketball game at U of A, and we got hooked. We put our deposit down for season tickets August 4th at 11:30 a.m. I will be your newest season ticket holder.
And I think the difference is the lower bowl this year, it's all reserved. Yeah. So, yeah, good.
That's great.
Now, who else is the new season ticket holder? No, come on.
Right here. We got lots. I have to tell you, I've been here since 1988, going to lots of basketball games. And I went with my daughter to the NIT championship game a couple years ago. One of the best basketball games I've ever seen in Macau. It was fantastic.
We're going to try to sell out Macau a couple more times this year.
I love that.
First game.
Coach Barnes, after you spoke to our club a couple of years ago, I did what you asked. I went to a game. I got hooked, and I just renewed my season tickets.
Thank you.
Question for you. Your Hannah Poyer, she's got a lovely touch from 3 points.
Yeah.
And as I listen to games, and Joan Bonassini keeps saying, oh, here comes the 3-point shooter.
Yeah.
It seemed as the year progressed, she passed up more and more 3-point shots when she was open. And I was watching to see if she made a terrific pass. But often she didn't, and I just could not figure out what was going on. What was going on?
I don't know. Because she's such a good shooter. I'm like, you have to shoot the ball. I don't know. I felt the same way this year. We get her open looks. I felt like maybe she struggled with confidence a little bit. But she's a great shooter. Like, I want her to shoot. She has the green light, even if she's a little bit, a little bit contested shot. She could take it, but I don't know. I think sometimes Helena's on siesta sometimes. You know, in Spain they have a siesta, so sometimes I have to snap her out of siesta mode. Because that's the Spain mentality. But she's getting better, and she's actually playing really well for the national team, but we need her to be more aggressive. Because as you guys saw, so think of our team last year. We have Aerie. We are one of the best defensive teams in the country, hands down. But we couldn't shoot the ball. Like, so everybody just kind of played in the paint. So this year, you're going to see we've added like four shooters. So to spread the floor, and Aries like, well, you didn't have those shooters, but I was here. Hi, Aries, we think you're those shooters. But so, yeah, she needs to take over sauce. But you'll see Matt. So now you guys are going to watch Madison Connor. She was our freshman that we took from high school last year, so she's going to be a freshman this year. She will not pass up a shot. Now, she has this much space, she's shooting a perfect mentality. But yes, to let her play, we got to work on her. She needs to come back a lot more aggressive. She's a great player.
Coach, can you explain the transfer portal and what it means to your team going forward?
Yeah, so the transfer portal is just, it's an avenue for players if they're not happy to transfer. So for us, we lost three players this year. So if you're not happy or you don't want to wait to play or you want to play more, three of our players that went in, they didn't play at all. So, you know, Tara, Mara, and Marta. So you can enter the portal and then you're like a free agent, basically. So you're open to be recruited by anybody in the country. Once you're in that portal, your name is in there, you can be contacted. So most of the schools are looking at portals every day. It kind of makes it like a wild, wild west because it's like transfer this and that, and it's kind of crazy, but I think it was like 500 kids or something last year. And they just passed this rule that you don't have to sit. So if you transferred once, you don't have to sit the year. Before you get to transfer, you had to sit and do an academic year and play. This year, you don't have to. Interconference or out of conference. So I just saw a player from Oregon. But I was not so happy. And I was like, why didn't I have to ask for permission to be a player? But so I'm going to the Ducks when we play them. But she's a Phoenix kid, Taylor Chavez, and we got her. So you're going to see there was been movement in the Pac-12. Washington kids went to Colorado. So you'll see that. But it's just a way for them to transfer. So the reality is, we're gonna have 15 players this year, we'll lose a couple kids. Because when you have 15 players, you have 10 players that aren't happy. So, because then 10 players don't play at all, and then the other five that start wish they could play more. That's just kind of how it is. So it's just the nature of kind of the schools now. The positive thing for us is I got a fifth year out of portal, arrived, so we needed more like presence inside. So if you looked against Stanford in a championship game, we couldn't score inside. Well, now we got a big girl that can score inside. She was one of the most efficient players in the country. She was at one point shooting like 67%, and she's a big body. Now, she's not going to be out there trapping and doing all that stuff because it's not her, but she's hard to stop on the block. So we added her, and then we added Taylor Chavez. So we also got two good players on the transfer portal. But it's kind of crazy. I think you're going to see that transfer portal increased by hundreds in 2 years because the COVID year, those kids couldn't take visits. So they came, like, we have Corey too from Vanderbilt. So we have three players that came to our school without ever being on the West Coast or seeing Arizona. So I think when you have a lot of other kids doing that, I think they're not going to stay at their schools. Like, if they don't like it, I think you're going to see a lot more.
All right, we have a question over here from Bruce.
Coach, congratulations on last season. You've done an amazing job as far as involving players from a community service standpoint. And as you know, we happen to have this car show in the middle of October. And we would love if the players might be willing to come out and do a little community service work.
I know, it's just the timing of it. We never can go. It's just like during practice or... So you guys have to change the date. No, or if we know months ahead of time, maybe we can shift to practice. The hard thing is, like with the men's team last year, we could never change practice. So yeah, but we can try to work on it. Maybe if we know when it's at, Jessica can help. So we'll try because we'd love to go every year. But like, we can't, like, you know, we can't. We gotta get better. So we'll try.
Maybe if we gave him a ride in the Corvette or something. Gary over here has a question for you.
Thanks for coming, Coach. How are the kids, and can you tell us some stories?
Yeah, so the first thing, I wouldn't recommend having a kid at 44, and I wouldn't recommend having a kid right before season. So, I am 44 years old. So before, I only wanted two kids. Like, we had our son, we're like, oh, we want a daughter. We knew we had kids later. So, it was like going to be like a 5% chance to have another kid. So I was like, oh, I was getting in shape. I lost 25 pounds. You guys saw I was skinnier last year. So I got in shape. I was like, I'm getting my body back. And then one game, I was like sweating like crazy. I don't sweat a lot. I was like, why am I sweating? Like, something's wrong. And then took a pregnancy test, it was positive. Took another one, it was positive. Took two more, it was still positive. So I was like, oh, this is a problem. So I was hiding it because I had some complications before. And then COVID was the best thing that happened for me because I was hiding out. So I was like, 2, 3, 4, 5 months. And then no one knew, and I announced it on the show. It just kind of, I forgot, I didn't announce it yet. And I talked about it on the show, so everybody found out that I was like 6 months pregnant. But so it wasn't really planned or expected. And so now it's for sure done. Now I'm way too old. But it wasn't fun to see geriatric pregnancy. I was like offended. But it was, I mean, 44, so I'm gonna be like 60 with the babies and fifth grade, but it was hard having a baby like right when season started. It was just, I took like a couple weeks off. I was on, so I had a C-section, and I was on Zoom calls 4 days after.
Oh my God.
So all you women that know, and I'm still breastfeeding, so that's why it went viral. So the whole world knows I breastfeed now, thanks to Hollywood. Because at the championship game, normally you have to come for a couple hours. Men, you don't know, but women, you do. So you have to call. And then during the game, I was feeling a little pressure. I was like, oh, I'm going to be too stressed. I won't have a lot of milk. And so during the game, I was like, I don't want to have wet spots on my feet. So I was like, I got to pump the button. So I go to pump, and it was private. I would have never told anybody. I go to pump, and I walk out, and like someone, Holly Rowe, she's like a pretty famous broadcaster, she asked someone else, what was taking the Via so long? They were like, she was pumping. So then like 5 million people found out I was pumping, and I was like, what the hell? But I'll tell you guys a funny story really quick. Okay. And this is like what my players see, so they're learning, they're seeing a lot. So I'm pumping at halftime, you're like connected, you have all this construction thing. So I have these pumps on, the hands free, you know, you guys, let me know what I'm talking about. So I have the brush, so I put like a little cloth, and I have the top of the team. So I put this on, I was talking to the team, they see these things under. And I'm talking, I'm like, this is what we have to do for the second half, and it falls. So all you see is my nipples, the thing, because before the game, I couldn't pump because of the media obligations. I didn't have a choice, so that was my moment. But I didn't even know I pumped.
I have a question here. Coach, thanks for being here. Fantastic. Change the subject a little bit. Could you give us kind of a brief on how do you recruit these people from Turkey and the best in the world?
Yeah, so we're not recruiting as much overseas because the reality is that the transition is really hard. Before I couldn't get the best American players, so I was trying to like supplement a few European players. Last year we lost four European players. So I think we got better fast, and so now that we're getting better Americans, I'm not going to go to Europe as much. Now, I took two European players this year, but they're really elite. So I took the girl from Estonia. She's a very, very good guard. It was heavily recruited by the whole Pac-12. She's like a blonde, a shifty guard who can score. And then I took one player from Spain who has to pass all the English exams to come. But they're the two best European players in the class. But we're not going to have a team of like 5 or 6. Because now I can get the Maya Najis, I can get the Kaylin. So we can get better American players. And I think for a university, it costs a lot to bring foreign players. And so you don't want foreign players that's costing the school double sitting. It's just not the avenue you want to go. But now we don't have to. We're in a different situation. But now I'm constantly recruiting against Stanford, UCLA, Louisville, UConn. So now it's just really competitive. So, and there's this thing called NLI now. So now it's really competitive because the athletes can make money. So you can like sell your likeness, you can have camps, you can sign autographs, make money. So it's really competitive. So with schools like Texas and Oregon, we have a little bit of a disadvantage because they have such a big brand. So a lot of players are going for that. So if you see players with like, Sedona Prince is like a pretty popular player. She's got like millions of followers. So they can now make money off that because the company can say, hey, I paid you $10,000. You know, take a picture of this water. And they have 1 million followers, but the players can make money. So So I think you're going to see really elite players make money or really attractive players just for marketing. So I think that some players will be really mad because if they're not that good, not that cute, they're probably not going to be
When are we going to see the Adia Barnes breast pumps?
I'm on the home stretch. I'm
almost done. Kate, here, ask a quick question.
Just a quick comment, Coach. We all admire your athletic prowess, but what I was most taken with was your demeanor courtside and the level that you maintained in the high stress times and in the quiet time. You were incredible in being a positive role model for those young women, and I commend you for that.
Thank you. It's hard. I'm not like, just even in life, I'm not super up and down. I'm pretty. So I just, like, it's a stressful moment, but me getting stressed on the sideline and yelling, it doesn't, to me, that's not coaching. So I'm honest. Sometimes I'll say, Ari, you're playing awful right now. You know, I'm just like, hey, you need to play harder. If you're not making your shots, you need to get to the rim. So I just try to be more constructive versus yelling, because then it just goes in one ear out the other. But it was a stressful moment. I have not felt pressure like that. That was a very, in those moments, it's hard, because there's so much that's going on. But I just try to keep my composure, because I think your team is a reflection of you. And if I'm all throwing stuff and doing all that, I think the team gets really tense. And I don't think we would have made it as far. But a lot of that's also my personality. I'm not someone that I don't yell and stuff. I may like say something mean, but he's like, you should cook clean more. I'm like, you should marry an Italian. I'm American. I'm not like a yeller. I don't yell, and that's just kind of my personality. But I have to be who I am, so I just try to be authentic. Yeah.
Good. Coach Barnes, thanks for taking our question.
I think we actually be able to use the microphone now to touch it, you know, because Coach and I are about the same height. So, Coach, a couple things. First, as you know, we have our own library, Reese Library, and the book this time is by LeBron James, and it's I Promise. We'll put this book in our library. We'd like for you to sign it, personalize it. And that'll go in there, so I'll get you pinned in a second. And second, Coach, I know I talked to you a month or so ago about being the Grand Marshal at the car show. Yeah. And you said, Mark, what does that entail? And I said, we're going to develop it as we go along. And I'll tell you, part of being the Grand Marshal at the car show is actually being at the car show.
I know.
I'm just saying. So as you guys
really got to try hard to get up.
I will tell you, one of the most fun times we had, Janine and I went to the baby shower and went by to have a chance to, you know, we didn't get to hug or do any of that stuff. It was just kind of one of those drive-by things, but it was really great. The highlight was it, the team leading us on mopeds through the neighborhood to go by and
like
say hi
to... You know those fat scooters everybody has? Have you guys seen those? Yeah. On the fat scooters.
So, Coach, thank you, as always, for being here. And she's going to stick around afterwards for the photo, so if you've got more questions, don't be shy. So we're going to hop back on the birthdays, because we forgot our friend Andy, who was born July 31st. He joined November 18th, November 2018, excuse me. His classification is real estate investments. He was optimized investments. A couple things you don't know about him. You don't get any thoughts. He has 13 cats, and he sits on the board of directors of the Hermitage No-Kill Shelter. He joined Rotary as a way to give back to the community. He stays with the amazing people, and he still considers himself a relatively new member who remains excited to be engaged as our club moves forward. Andy, come on, say a few words.
Very happy to be here, and nice to celebrate my birthday with such a wonderful group. I'll make it quick and donate most of my time back to Mark here. I just have a check for the Rotary Foundation, and I'll give you back my minute. Thanks, Mark.
That's song would be Brief Be Bright Be Gone. I am thinking Andy probably gets like the winner with that. We're going to jump into a history moment here. Part of our goal every meeting, especially this being our centennial, is to have a history moment. Bob, if you could come up. Bob Schaff joined in April of 92. I was actually on his board back in the day. His classification is consulting, marketing. He owns Customers for Life Consulting. He's a U of A grad. And he was the president of Rotary back in 2003 and 2004, here with the history moment. Bob?
Mike Anderson, Rotarian. Mike joined our club 40 years ago, and since that time has made and continues to make significant contributions and have a positive impact on our club and our community. Arguably, Mike's most significant contribution to our club and our history was his 10 Bucks Wins a Dream Home project, which raised over $250,000 for our foundation in 2001, 20 years ago. Let's hear from Mike about the dream home from his past president's video. Mike Anderson, Rotarian.
Wins a Dream Home project, which in a nutshell was the club bands together and builds a house in town and garners as much support from the community, contractors and cabinet makers and framers and air conditioning guys, all through the contacts of the club, and then proceeds to sell $10 raffle tickets to a lucky winner who would win that house. And that was the goal, kind of a vision that I had initially, and ultimately that program turned out to be fine. We made $250,000 and proved to our membership and ourselves that we could undertake a significant project that involved our participation as well as support from the community, and we could bring in other nonprofit organizations such as the Boy Scouts and the Food Bank and Ronald McDonald House to help sell our tickets, and some 25 to 30 contractors, and 25 plus different media types all joined forces to promote the Dream Home project and build it and promote our ticket sales. So at the end of the day in February of 2010, 2001, we had this big gala event, and everybody who participated came. We hosted all these persons and companies that helped us, and we pulled the winning ticket out, and some lucky person won a $150,000 dream home, and it happened to be the daughter of one of our members, Pete Raguzin, and we raised $250,000 out of that effort, which went into the club foundation and resulted in having us have over $1 million in our foundation corpus. It was a very satisfying event for the whole club, and the biggest thing that it accomplished was that it proved to the club that we had the ability to undertake a major project, that we could garner support from the community, and that we could truly raise significant funds and allow us then to go on and do other big projects for communities.
$1,450. You're still going to win $110 today, which is pretty big. So, here it is.
I want to win.
Yeah. 0478.
There's our winner.
Right there, right there on the front row. I'm bringing you $110 right now. Thank you. Yeah. And you can say Adia gave you money. Yes. We didn't violate any NCAA rules by doing this, so thank you. Take it away, Mark.
Just a couple things. So don't forget, after this meeting, we're going to do the photo shoot. For those that have additional questions for Adia, just go for it. Coach, I'm going to send you a link to the program. It's being recorded. I know you love to watch video. And that way you can see all the nice things that Kim and Air said about you and your inspirational message. You can hear what Mr. Farhang had to say, which was exceptionally nice as well. So I'll send you that link as we record all of these. That'll be great. take a look at the board here. We've been talking about this for a while. And, you know, we've got the pandemic that we think subsiding. Now we've got this Delta thing. And I'm kind of tired of people saying, would you ask so-and-so not to hug me? And, you know, I don't like this and I don't like that. So here's what we're going to do. You see this? We're going to have these available. This is a mock-up that we've done. These will probably be available in about a week. Be available in about a week. If you have a desire to have that sticker put on your badge, all you have to do is send a note to Garina, and the staff will affix that to your badge, and that'll let people know that you're not a hugger or a shaker. And that's just fine. That's just fine. Either one of those things. So we now are going to get to the Irv's fly fishing, and we have a new person here. Waki and her husband and their whole family caught this really nice king salmon off of Vancouver Island. That cost her $100. She's getting ready to leave Friday, I think. Waki, am I right with that? To go back up and do some more fishing. So if you want to, you know, be on Irv's Fly Fishing Rotary Fund, all you got to do is reach out to me, and I can catch a fish and name it after you. I'm actually going to be fishing over the next couple of days, so you just shout when you're ready for that. We do have, where's my buddy Jim Levinsky? Jim, come on up. I know you have a couple of messages.
He's got the yellow tail, too.
Thanks. I'm going to follow Mark's advice and be quick and be gone. on September 12th, the Daily Star is going to run a 28-page insert, similar to what the Festival of Books does each year. The only difference is it will be entirely dedicated to the Rotary Club of Tucson, the Centennial, and the Tucson Classics Car Show. We're controlling all of the content, including the advertising. So just this morning, I know all of you have read the email that I sent out to you that give you the specifics on how you can buy an ad in this insert to support your business, or if you want to just send a commemorative memorabilia thing for thanking a member or a mentor or something else from there. So September 12th, that's going to run. We need these commitments back by August 13th. President Mark has already stepped up and bought a page. Gary Hirsch has done it. Bobby Larson has done it already just from this morning. Sponsorship opportunities are still available for the car show. So if you have any interest in that, please let me know. And finally, the Centennial event on September 25th. The tickets will be going out, or the ticket invitation will be going out soon, buy early, and get signed up. Thanks.
Good, thank you. Where's Ken White? Ken, can you come on up? I know you've got an announcement as well. And then I know Joe. Where's Joe Dennis Esten? Joe, you might want to come up as well.
We're well on our way to raising $67,293 through the Centennial Auction, but we're not there yet. We still need your help in securing items for the auction, as well as sponsors and bidders. Thanks to your efforts and the efforts of our committee, comprised of Jeannie Zeta, Faye Morse, Tina Kern, Gary Olson, Jim Rubianis, Lynn and Dan DeVoe, Abby Nagby, and Sarah Gar, we now have 138 auction items. Actually, we had them yesterday. What came in today is included. 138 auction items committed, and another 117 items in the works for the online auction. And you've seen the list of some of the more exciting items. The next slide. Add to those items an autographed basketball from the 1997 U of A basketball championship season, a new bicycle courtesy of Fairwheels Bicycles, and a classic original Peugeot mountain bike, a beautiful custom-made Mesquite coffee table, two nights stay package at Hacienda del Sol Guest Ranch, a commissioned painting by Diana Medeiros, and what do you see? You begin to see the variety and depth of some of the more recent acquisitions. Our committee has begun to follow up calls on those potential gifts outstanding, along with those that have been offered, but we're not there yet. Our website, we were trying to shorten the link and it didn't work. So if you try to reach the website for the auction today or tomorrow, it won't work. Wait a couple days and then you can go online and you can see all the details. Last slide. You can help by delivering on your commitments for items and support and secure additional items. You can help by volunteering to assist us with the pickup of items and then after the auction giving a couple hours to help distribute at the storage site the items to the winning bidders. And you can help by going full bore for the next 4 weeks to ensure that we have a successful auction and event. We're down to the last 4 weeks. Please let Jeannie and me know as you firm up your commitments and if you can help in any of the ways I've just mentioned. Thank you.
Ticket sales, car show, who's excited?
Yeah.
That's the best we can do. Who's excited?
Yeah.
We have 16 plus Rotarians who have already sold 100 tickets. Plus. Some cases plus, Mark. And let's see those beautiful Rotary Gold cooling towels wave in the audience. These are the folks that are selling those tickets, and we're going to have a lot more tickets sold before she's all done. One of the things that we really have to build on from last year is we really created a lot of cool marketing techniques for us to sell tickets. And we're not stopping. This year we also have more resources for you. Make sure you turn in your ticket money, Roger, at the back ticket sales table and pick up another ticket money envelope. Classic Club tickets are ready. Is that good? Classic Club?
Yes.
Yeah, that's a lot of fun. And if you haven't gone or sold tickets, do both. Small and large posters to promote the raffle are available at the ticket sales table. More plastic holders with business cards to promote online sales. You can have as many plastic business card holders as you have businesses, or you could also grab some of the neat business cards. Forms to reach out to nonprofits or other Rotary clubs to be ticket selling partners. Check with Roger, who already has a list of those contacted already. So other Rotary clubs, other service, you name it, ask them to sell tickets. It's a great fundraiser for them. Directions on how to use the email template, which we started last year, to ask your contacts to buy tickets online. And if members here of new events where we do some event selling, every other week now we've been at the wonderful site there, in Little Anthony's. But if there's more places we can sell tickets, it's a great way for new members to sell tickets and break in. Are we going to have a great sale?
Yeah.
Oh, if you want me to leave, you got to be louder. Are we going to have a great sale?
Yeah!
Thank you. Go get them.
Oh, man, I think somebody missed his microphone. I don't know what's going on. As we adjourn, I just want to thank everybody for joining us, whether you're a virtual guest or whether you're here in person. Thank you for being here. If on your way out, you'd like to donate to the scholarship cups, there's in the back tables. Also, don't forget to turn in your badges as you leave. If you've not received your Rotary pin, please see Dorina and Carrie in the back. They can take care of you. If you do want to get one of those flags, just send them an email, let them know that. I'd like to say a huge thank you to my pal, Ollie and Tim, and the rest of the staff here, and obviously Kristen, who's a member of our club. Kristen, thank you for bringing these hoodlums with you. The one hoodlum and the rest of the staff.
Be nice to
seriously, Ollie, thank you guys for sponsoring, and you've got a nice banner that I hope you will take with you. Happy birthday, Robin, Tom, Andy, thank you guys. Please stick around for the group photo. Next week's speaker is going to be the cathedral, and we should hear from the bishop and Sister Charlotte and some other folks. So as we adjourn, before we adjourn, two other things. Don't forget, we've got cards to sign for Ernie, because as you know, he's going to be going to the hospital. We want to keep him cheerful. And then finally, I'd be remiss if I didn't thank my pal Chuck Sawyer. You know, Adia, as you recall, when were making the runs and stuff. I got a kitchen pass and I was fishing in New Zealand. I wasn't able to be at a couple of those games, and I know Chuck just took it upon himself to go out and do stuff. And Chuck, I know we thanked you before, but thank you again. Okay, so time for a little toast and adjourn. Effective leadership is aggressive and exciting when seen in action. It seems somewhat effortless to those who are observing. To some leaders, I think it comes very easy. To others, not so much so. It takes a lot of effort. We know it isn't easy, but you sure make it look that way, Coach. Here's to our pal and honorary member, Adia Barnes, an amazing leader on and off the court. You make us proud. Yeah. Yeah. We accepted the photo. We're adjourned. Where is our amazing photographer? There he is. Chris is going to direct the traffic now.
We're all in the photo. The photo's going to be taken this table.
If you want to take the photo, if you want to take the photograph, this is what's going to happen. These three tables are going to be removed by some volunteers. We're going to move the chairs over here. You guys are all going to be here in front of the podium, and this is where these three tables are. I would like some people to come up on stage. We have two rows back here. And Mark. So that'll be up front there. So we're going to get these three tables right here. And I'm going to be in the back of the room right there on the left. So you guys are going to be looking south. I'll be photographing north. So we have some people up on the stage. If you want to be on the stage in the background here, we have about 20, 30 people up here on the stage. Don't be shy.
Taller short should be on the stage.
There you go.
No, tall or short.
I would say short. That's.
These are all tall.
Yeah, they need another row in front. But thank you.